Yippee-Ki-Yay, mother.
Welcome to the party, pal.
Welcome to Yippee-Ki-Yay, mother podcast. Here we are on another great day in a tough week. Not going to lie, it's been a tough week. We all know. Today's movie I brought to our wonderful show. I'm Ralph Quartucci.
I'm Sean Paul Murphy.
And I'm John Quartucci.
We are the three basically remaining members of this podcast. We've been
the three amigos.
We keep losing people. People don't want to do it. Hassan said he watched Cape Fear and he can't deal with a happy movie right now. Whatever that means, I have no idea.
I think Wojo was just busy. I think we'll be back.
I'm sure. Hassan is triggered for some reason. Although I have to say, Hassan was in the protest last Monday night. Mm-hmm. He got caught up in all that. He was actually in the house where the 70 people were rescued. So he may be feeling a little. Yeah. So maybe that's why he's out. But anyway, so the reason I picked this movie is because in these tough times, we do need a savior coming from above us. And by that, I mean, of course, Superman.
Oh.
Okay. Sorry, Sean. Okay. I know. As we can see, we give away the game all the time with signs, and John always has them in the back. Let me explain why I chose this movie. On top of what's going on this week, needing some kind of just escape from everything, is, you know, in this pandemic, we're sitting at home a lot. So I'm watching a lot of YouTube videos, maybe too many. Getting obsessed about things I shouldn't be obsessed about. Getting anxious about things I never used to get anxious about. So I turn on this one YouTube guy that I watch every once in a while. He's got a little YouTube channel where he talks about movies. And he basically broke down The Man of Steel. I don't know when that came out, 2018? Zack Snyder's Man of Steel.
Which is essentially a sequel to this movie.
No.
Superman Returns was.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, that's right. Superman Returns.
My point is, he was espousing the brilliance of Zack Snyder's Man of Steel, the greatest comic book movie and Superman movie ever made. And not once did he mention the 1978 Superman film. And I felt like we need to give it some love. So here we are. This is why we're here. I want to show one little clip, do a little musical clip at the beginning of this to get us into the spirit of what's going on. And then I'll talk about who was in it, stuff like that. And then we'll do a round robin.
And Ralph, don't forget, if you like this, subscribe, go for notifications, leave us comments. We need to spread the word.
We're trying to. We had one comment the other day. Someone suggested a movie. We may do that down the road. Yes.
Yeah, let's do it. Maybe
John is our social media guy. Turns out we have to use one of the old guys to be social media guy. But hey, what are you going to do, right? I don't care how we do it. So let me just drop into the screen. Sorry about all the clicking and all that. And just play this little clip just to get us in the mood.
Oh, that
now, you can't lose with a John Williams score, number one.
No.
Right?
A Oscar-nominated John Williams score.
It was? It should have been.
Iconic score.
And just brilliant. Okay. One other thing, Sean, you need to know, and our viewers need to know. John and I actually went to the 1978 New England premiere of Superman.
We had a friend that worked at a movie studio who gave us passes to it. So we
John
were there
with some. John, do you have any swag? Any swag from
that? I don't want to get jumping
oh,
ahead.
Too early? I'm jumping?
Not there yet.
Okay. All right. So Superman, the movie, came out in 1978. John, can you tell me the tagline that started the whole thing for this movie?
You'll believe a man can fly.
Right.
In fact, the first poster for this movie was the Superman shield with a red, blue, and yellow streak behind it. And that was the tagline. That was the only advertising for it when it first came out. They didn't promote any of the stars yet because it hadn't been casted yet.
Wow. Yeah. So, and they had to make a guy fly, or they had to make us believe a man could fly, right. and they pulled it off. Okay, so it came out in 1978. Directed by Richard Donner. Written, one of the writers, Mario Puzo.
With they were all great writers.
Oh yeah.
Who were the
Tom Mankiewicz.
Okay. I was surprised when I saw when I watched this again that Mario Puzo wrote this one as well.
Yeah, but his script was 3.5 hours long.
Well, his stuff's always long, right? Yeah. Isn't that his?
Yeah. What about The Godfather?
Well, yeah, Telly Savalas. Oh no, you're right. But his there was no way they were going to be able to film what he wrote. But they thought that by having Puzo be the author after The Godfather, it's going to give this movie a lot more credibility than it probably would have had.
So the top people billed on this movie were Marlon Brando, Gene Hackman. Who was number three?
Christopher Reeve was number three. Right.
Wasn't an introducing Christopher Reeve. Had he done something before this?
No, he was on Broadway.
Okay.
I think he might have done one movie, but.
Yeah. He was an actor, but nobody knew who he was.
Right.
And they found basically the perfect Superman. So, comes out in 1978. We did believe a man could fly. And I don't know what its box office was. Did Roger Ebert do anything on this, Sean? Yes, he did.
Would you like to hear what Roger Ebert had to say?
I would love to hear what Roger had to say.
The first time we see Superman in his red, blue, and yellow uniform is nearly an hour into Superman. Perhaps the filmmakers agreed with Spielberg's famous statement that Jaws would work better the longer he kept the shark off the screen. That means the film doesn't open like most superhero movies or James Bond with a sensational pre-title sequence. To be sure, it opens on the planet Krypton with his father, Yor-El, preparing him to launch into space. But those aren't action sequences. They provide weight to the origin story every superhero requires. We believed a man could fly. He gave this 4 stars.
Nice.
In fact, let me go a little further since that wasn't really a good thing. In fact, Richard Donner's Superman 1978 is surprisingly slow starting. The scenes of young Clark Kent's boyhood and adolescence seem pointless if we didn't know. And someday, that child will grow up to be Superman. The high school football scene where the future Man of Steel gets bullied and has a cute girl snatched away from him pay off later in establishing Clark Kent as a shy and, yes, mild-mannered reporter, but they also raise intriguing questions. Who is this being anyway? Yeah. So there's Superman for you.
Right. So, you know, everybody knows the plot. Krypton's going to blow up. Jor-El, what's his father's name?
Jor-El. Yeah. RJ.
Hatches a plan with his wife to send their newborn son to Earth to save one person from Krypton.
Well, you got to pronounce it like Marlon Brando. Krypton.
Krypton.
He never said Krypton.
Well, he was top billed. He can say anything he wants.
He's already in the out-of-control phase of his career at this point.
So he knew that he'd send this guy and that the Earth's atmosphere and the sun would make him superhuman, so he's going to have to deal with, you know, the responsibility of that. Marlon knew that. There's a whole scene where the spaceship's flying through space, and he's learning the whole history of the Earth, the world, our world. Lands in Kansas.
Yep.
I'm sorry, I don't know all the details. Ma and Pa Kent find him, adopt him.
Glenn Ford.
And, you know, he learns his lessons from his dad about responsibility, like all superhero origin movies where someone's going to pass away. He always has to give the speech right before he goes about you have to handle the responsibility.
With great power come great responsibility.
Right.
All those powers, and I couldn't save them.
Right. So he learns his upbringing, or he learns where he came from. He has the Fortress of Solitude, ends up in Metropolis as a reporter, Clark Kent. Nobody could recognize him with his glasses on. You have to suspend a little disbelief, but this movie makes you actually believe that because Christopher Reeve did such a great job.
Thank you.
Handling the physicality of that. He really did. I mean, when you look at how his shoulders droop, everything he did, actually, you believe that he would have been able to pull that off. In our cynical times now, no way. Like, even in The Man of Steel, they don't even attempt to do that. You know. And, of course, you know, he meets Lex Luthor, the super criminal of the Earth, who thinks he's the smartest guy in the world. And now he has to fight, you know, he has to prove that he's the smartest by going out to Superman. And everybody knows the story. I don't need to go rehash. I just think the innocence of this film, all the work they put into it to make us believe the guy could fly, and the way Christopher Reeve, and frankly, Margot Kidder, to me, is still my favorite Lois Lane. I thought she was fantastic. for the times, 1978. She really played a liberated woman who you could believe was as good a reporter as she was. And
Mary
and
Howard Hawks. Though
she, could also, she couldn't spell.
That's right. Right.
Spelling the words for it. Be
there's
like,
only one P in rapist.
It's like there's only one T in the. You know?
But you could believe that she could fall in love with that guy, too. It wasn't like she was this, you know. And we'll get into
he
her.
Must also be the highest paid reporter in the history of the world, considering that penthouse apartment she had.
Oh, yeah, that was a nice place.
Yeah.
Great scene, too. And very adult scene when you look back at that.
Some of
the lines about pink and some of the things they were doing were pretty kind of flew over my head in 1978. Although, how old was I? I would have been 16, 15.
I was 4.
No, you're 10 X.
I was 12, 8. Okay. No, but we saw this and I probably didn't catch any of that, but it sure now I caught what they were doing. It was awesome. It is awesome. And I think it doesn't get enough props anymore. That, I mean, this fact that this guy on YouTube didn't even mention this movie when he's talking about the greatest Superman comic book movie ever made just doesn't make any sense to me.
It's absolutely absurd.
Yeah. Gene Hackman, fantastic as Lex Luthor. His sidekick, what was his sidekick's name?
Ned Beatty.
Otis.
Ned Beatty. Otis, and then Miss
Jess Bucker!
She was great. Valerie Perrine.
Valerie Perrine.
In her prime. I mean, my God. Gorgeous.
Kissing him.
And she played that woman great. Anyway, I don't want to rehash it. Everybody knows the plot. I just want to get your thoughts on the movie, and then we can talk about some other. I'm going to show a couple other scenes that I thought were pretty important. As a matter of fact, the helicopter scene, just I remember. I think we cheered. I think people literally cheered when he pulls that. You see that S? People went crazy.
The theater, and those were all critics. When he saved the helicopter and her, the place went crazy.
Crazy.
I mean,
I remember.
I don't even remember. I don't remember seeing that again in a movie. I mean, absolutely
not like that. Yeah, not like that. I mean, that was because it was a long time coming.
Yeah.
Before I hand it off to Sean, there is something I want to get your opinion on. When he's growing up with Ma and Pa Kent, what year is that supposed to be? Well, visually, it looks like what? 1920?
How many years was he gone? He was 13. He was gone 13 years. I'm assuming the film is set in 1978 or 1970.
Right. When he ends up
at the 30th year, it was 1978.
When he flies out of the Fortress of Solitude, we land in 1978.
That's right.
And he's 30. Okay. He's 30? I thought he was 25. 30?
No, 30. 12 years.
Okay. Okay. So backtrack 12 from that. That puts you at 68.
Right. But they played it 40s.
It was 1940s.
Yeah.
So that's a time shift that.
But they did that purposely.
Of course. Because yeah,
plus it was rural. It's ruralism.
It's also evoking Americana, and it puts you right in the paintings of.
Although the music they were playing was Rock Around the Clock.
Yeah.
1950, right?
Which was a Glenn Ford movie used in Blackboard Jungle.
Okay. So they were messing around with time, and nobody cared.
Right.
I mean, exactly. I didn't even notice it until I saw it this last time. I'm like, that's a big jump between. Anyway, I just wanted to throw that out. Sean?
Well, I forgot one thing, just to that point, I forgot he was gone so long. You know, that is 12 years.
Right. Yeah. He throws that thing and goes.
Well, the allegory is 30 years old. Jesus Christ was supposed to.
Well, I mean, that's why I started with Savior.
That's why it was 30. Yeah.
Well, the other one, what was it? Superman Returns. There was so much Christ symbolism in that movie.
Too much.
You know, it was unbelievable.
Same thing with Man of Steel. They did the same thing.
Well, same Man of Steel. They did the same thing. I mean, they literally show him.
Not subtle.
No, they have him right next to Jesus.
Yeah.
Right. And the red globe behind
the window. Yeah.
And it looked like Jesus wearing a cape in one of the scenes.
No. Yeah.
Anyway, Sean.
Yeah, I just wanted to see Christopher Reeves with that beard and mustache, you know, doing a little bit longer.
I liked what he did in 3. Was it 3 where he fights himself? Anyway.
That was 3. Richard Pryor.
Yeah. So I'm going to have a confession here. First, I did not see this movie in the theaters when it first came out.
That's a shock.
Well, the problem was I wasn't driving at that point myself, and my local theater had closed. It was my theater closed in 1976 when porno for a year or two closed, and then they reopened it in 1979. So although I went out, you know, although I went to other places to see Jaws and all, I did not see this. The first time I saw this movie was right after it came out. In a Super 8 cutdown, 20-minute cutdown version.
Oh, my goodness.
You know, so I saw it there. And
but you've never seen it on the big screen?
No, I did later. I later saw some revival. But no, it's this was always my favorite superhero movie. I was curious. I wish some of our younger members would have shown up to see how it plays today. I mean, this was more comedy than, you know, most of them. And I think they were hedging their bets whether people were going to laugh, you know, at it, because, you know, 78 was a kind of a cynical time, you know, and to see the man, it's like, you'll believe he'll fly. You'll believe that because they weren't sure that the audience would, you know? So I think they were kind of hedging their bets. And the second one has a lot of comedy, and the third one has Richard Pryor in it, you know? Yeah. So I did see the second one in the theaters.
Well, the second one was, the comedy came from the second director that took over for Richard Donner.
Yeah, Richard Lester.
There's that whole cut, that Richard Donner cut.
Yeah.
Of Superman 2, which is a completely different play.
Right.
I haven't seen that one yet.
Yeah, because they were shooting that at the same time they were shooting
this. Donner filmed 75% of Superman 2. Lester reshot it.
Yeah, Lester added all that silliness with the breath and some of the stuff that was going on.
Lester did Superman 3, and that whole scene in the beginning, it was all slapstick at the very beginning with Richard Pryor.
Yeah.
So that completely changed the tone of the movie. And to your point, Sean, comedy, yes, but I just think it was a lighter tone.
I think it's humor.
I mean, some of it was like, you know, when he flies and the pimp says, that's a bad outfit.
Well, I think the slapstick came with Otis and Lex Luthor.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's also where all the slapstick.
Clark Kent was always stumbling, spilling things. And
well, I mean, isn't that part of
part of the disguise.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, I really love this film. I think it, you know, it's really trying to entertain, you know. It's, you know, nowadays you can see these superhero films. So many of them are, you know, they think the characters are Hamlet, you know. And this one, at least, it's enjoyable. Of course, my second favorite superhero movie is The Dark Knight, which is one of the ones that takes itself extremely seriously.
Yeah.
You know.
And now everybody's trying to emulate that and going away from this. I mean, Sam Raimi tried it with Spider-Man, right? He kind of went with the tone like this one.
Yeah.
The first Spider-Man.
And I really liked that first Spider-Man movie.
I mean, you got to remember, too, we had been watching Superman on television. Now, I didn't read the comics, but I had been watching that George Reeves Superman for years on TV. Yeah. Right?
And the Batman TV series.
Well, but Superman specifically, his whole thing and being in black and white. Right. So I remember when we saw this in 78. Now, there was a lot of lead up to this film. Right.
Yeah.
This was basically one of the first comic book movies they tried to make. Right. And they could have gone horribly bad if it didn't go well.
Yeah. And I think that's why they were hedging their bets.
And the reason everybody cheers when he pulls the shirt and you see that blue and red thing and the yellow is it's in color, too. It's the first time you've seen it on
Superman. The Superman George Reeves series was in color.
It was.
Yeah.
See, I have black and white.
I think I only saw it in black and white.
Yeah, I don't remember that.
Yeah, the last.
Maybe it was, but see again, that's hazy.
No, not maybe it was. It was.
Okay. Well, maybe we only had a black and white TV.
I'm going to research that one.
That's what I'm going to say. I'm going to retroactively say we only had a black and white.
See my Superman costume? That's George Reeves' costume.
Oh, did you guys see Hollywoodland?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ben
Affleck as George Reeves. I didn't see. That's an offshoot. We should maybe do that.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm sorry, Sean.
This was just an enjoyable movie. I was really. This is one of these films I've been kind of steering myself away from for like 20 years, not wanting to see it again.
Comic book films or?
No, this one in particular, because I enjoyed it so much. I was afraid that it wasn't going to hold up like how.
Oh, yeah. You know, I thought the same thing.
That's your common complaint. And this was really close to not holding up on the special effects at the time.
Well, the special effects, yes. But I mean, it holds up as a film.
The tone of the performances and the script is so good that even if the special effects, because I'll tell you what, it's like a film I used to love. I still love it, I guess, is Ghostbusters, the original.
Oh, great movie.
But the special effects, particularly like the lightning and all, I know how they did it, you know, and it looks so cheesy today.
Well, those were cheesy then.
Like, I don't like to watch the big scenes. I like the small scenes.
Yeah. What do you think Puzo added to this? Like what Puzo elements were added to Superman?
He was the one. I think he laid down the original groundwork. But let's not discount the other writers, Newman and Benton. I mean, they were really good writers. They wrote Bonnie and Clyde, Bad Company, a number of other films. They were they were really good writers too. So I think
Mankiewicz punched up all the
Mankiewicz. Yeah, Mankiewicz.
It was broken up into three sections, right? Krypton, Smallville, and Metropolis. And they were really three different visions because Smallville was a Norman Rockwell painting.
Right.
That's what it was supposed to be. Right. Metropolis was the Howard Hawks movies, Fast Dialogue, Margot Kidder. And Krypton was supposed to be the gravitas. I think Puzo had a lot to do with Krypton.
Well, he'd written for Marlon Brando before.
Yeah, well, exactly. So I think
Well, Mankiewicz, you got to remember, is off credit. And I'm sure he was kind of comic action, because if I'm not mistaken, he did some of my favorite James Bond films. Those, Man with a Golden Gun, Diamonds Are Forever, Live and Let Die. Definitely my favorite of the Roger Moore ones. You know, they were comic, but they weren't as stupidly comic as some of the later ones were. You know, I think he was also the first American writer to be involved in writing an official James Bond film.
Yeah, so they had a lot of strong people on. So Richard Donner had just done Omen, so this is his second film, I think, theatrical. He'd done a lot of television.
Well, Richard Donner was in the bathroom when he got the call from the Salkinds.
Oh, and he offered him
$1 million.
Right.
And he wrote it on a note, or I don't know if it was a matchbook, I think it was. He wrote $1 million to do Superman, and he has it framed up in his house, but he was in the bathroom. And he was thinking to himself, Superman. No, all he was thinking was $1 million to direct a movie, I'm in. But then he made the decision, if we're going to do it, it can't be a joke. It's got to be serious, because the first time the audience laughs when he comes out in that costume,
you're done.
Over.
Yeah.
Right.
So it has to be serious. It can still be funny. I think vermilitude or something.
Yeah.
He had a word that we have to take this seriously. We have to believe this guy can actually fly.
Yeah.
And that's why he ended up going with Christopher Reeve, because they wanted Redford. They wanted James Caan. They wanted Clint Eastwood.
They always go for the same guys. Redford was supposed to be the Godfather, too, or in the Godfather.
They screen tested one of the producers' dentist because he looked like Superman. And if you see the screen test of Christopher Reeve, first of all, he was about 35, 40 pounds lighter than he was in the movie, so he's real skinny. So they put him in the costume. It was the penthouse scene. So on the screen test, you see him on the penthouse sweating. He's got big sweat stains. And he jumps off the ledge and says, "Hello, Miss Lane." But he did it in a way that everyone was like, "This is the guy." I mean, he it wasn't a joke. He wasn't over the top. He just did it. And that's why they ended up going with him. And they wanted to put him in a muscle suit. And he ended up working with David Prowse, who was Darth Vader, and put on, 35 pounds of muscle.
Yeah.
And you can see it in the movie that actually during the movie he actually gets bigger. But he's and he was only 26 years old.
Yeah.
But he comes across as much older, doesn't he? He doesn't look like a 26-year-old.
No, he definitely looks older.
Yeah.
He did a great job. They found the right guy. Let me
know. Are you gonna? Because I'm ready to jump in.
Before I switch, I want to just show the scene that
The helicopter
scene that we talked about, and the fact that when I saw this in the movies, it was just insane.
The first time the public sees him.
Say, Jim, boom!
Excuse me.
That's a bad outfit.
Easy, miss. I've got you.
You've got me. Who's got you?
So that's just fabulous. Okay, John.
I could just sit here and watch the next 10 minutes of that movie.
Right? That's what I mean. That is what's – yeah, that makes it – like John always says, if you drop in the middle of this thing, you won't walk away from it. It's really good. Anyway, go ahead, John.
Rewatching it, though, like the Ebert review, I was really struck by how long it took to get him to Metropolis. You know, it really was a long time.
Well, they had all that stuff to set up.
And well, they were the first. I mean, that set the tone for all the other movies, all the other origin stories. They took the time to explain it. Plus, you had Marlon Brando. So they wanted that. I think it was probably a smart move. Now, if you notice in Superman 2, you see Superman right away.
Yeah.
So they didn't wait at all, because I'm sure their thinking was, are people going to buy this? And that's why.
I think a lot of that Brando stuff was shot during the first movie, too.
Oh, it was. All of it was.
Yeah, yeah.
All Brando's footage was Donner shot.
Yeah.
Are you done, Sean? I don't want to.
No, jump in.
So
I may cough.
I have to explain before we begin that I'm a huge comic book collector, and I am a huge
nerd alert.
Ralph knows this. I'm a huge Superman fan. One of my prized possessions, 1947 Superman comic.
Wow.
Yeah. I've got my Superman costume back there. Oh, and that little statuette, I don't know if you can see it, that's actually Christopher Reeve.
Because when do you wear the costume?
What was that?
When do you wear the costume?
That's between my wife and I. I'm not going to talk about
just
that.
On this. Lois, is that her name? What's your wife's name? LLL?
Those nights it is.
So, and I was a huge George Reeves Superman fan. I was a huge Super Friends. So when I heard this movie was coming out, I was just beside myself, but I was like, well, I just don't know how they're going to pull off the flying, because in a major motion picture, you don't want to see him standing like George Reeves used to do.
Yeah.
And I kept reading articles about it, and they were going to – I don't know, Sean, if you remember the old Rocket Man serials. They used to shoot a guy out of a cannon. That's how they made it look like he flew. They tried that. In the old Superman serial with Kirk Allen, it was live action, but all the flying scenes were animated, so he'd get behind a car, all of a sudden you see an animated figure fly, and they actually thought about that for this movie. I'm like, how are they going to do this? Then I read an article that they had a lot of footage that they couldn't use because you could see the wires.
Mm.
So I just didn't know what this was going to be like. I had really high expectations. So then we got the invite to go to the New England premiere. And first of all, the scale of it, like that opening scene in Krypton, You weren't expecting that from a comic book movie, right? Yeah. So right away, that set the tone. Then the scenes in Smallville. But when you actually see him, and this is something Ralph and I talked about, Richard Donner wasn't 100% sure it would work. You know, are people going to laugh? But the scene that convinced him, because Christopher Reeve is a pilot. So one of the things he was able to do in the flying scene, because he could fly, he knew how to position his body to do certain things flying. You see him in the Fortress of Solitude. He flies towards the camera. That was Christopher Reeves.
He did that.
So when Richard Donner saw that, that's when he cried and said, you know what? People are going to buy this. And for me, that was like the first time I really saw a man flying. So I was like, oh, my God. And then as the movie went on, the helicopter scene was just incredible, which, by the way, originally was only going to be – he was only going to save Lois Lane. The helicopter was not going to drop. They added that because Donner said, "Now we need a little more for this scene." And it was just great. And the scene where he flies away, she said, "Who are you? A friend." And then he kind of goes backwards and flies up. It was so cool. So for me as a lifelong Superman fan, it was just incredible. Lex Luthor, Gene Hackman was great, but Christopher Reeve, I love Henry Cavill. I think he's a great Superman. I think Christopher Reeve is the best superhero performance out of them all.
Because I hate to say I'd agree.
Because if you look at, you know, everyone says, well, how can people think it's Clark Kent and Superman? It's just glasses. But the one scene that explains it all is after he flies with Lois Lane and he's in the apartment and he's got the glasses on. And she goes in the bedroom, and he's looking at his glasses. And then all of a sudden,
he's ready to tell her.
But it looks like he gains a foot in height.
Yeah.
Straightens out his shoulder.
All body language.
His voice drops. Lois, there's something I have to tell you. And then, boom, he gets right back down. And the fact that he did that and made two distinct personalities, which I think is a great acting performance, where in all these other superhero movies, they don't do that. They certainly don't do it in the Superman movies. I give Christian Bale credit because it was his idea to do that, ruff, 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 you know, that voice, because people could pick up on it. I get that. But to me, the strength of him playing Superman is what made this movie. Because if you didn't buy into that with no cynicism, because if you know, he says, what are you here for? I'm here to fight for truth, justice, and the American way. But in Superman Returns, they said he's here to fight for truth, justice, and all that other stuff.
Yeah.
So to me, it was a movie with no cynicism. It was light because Superman is the opposite of Batman. Batman's dark. He lives in a dark place. Superman is supposed to be light. And unfortunately, with Man of Steel and Batman v Superman, they wanted to do this angst, this darkness that doesn't exist.
Well, they actually call him an alien, which we know he is. But you
yeah,
know,
but
they really
did that. I mean, they did that in the comics. But it was just it was way too dark. But I want to show you some other.
Well, I want to say, can I just say one thing? Batman v Superman. Terror. I left the theater.
It was
talk
awful.
About a movie that wouldn't get started.
Why'd you say Martha?
It was
like a Batman's origin movie, a Superman origin movie. Lex
I actually,
I mean, every Batman. How many Batman movies do we have to see the same scene of his parents getting killed? I mean, that's what you know.
I actually like Ben Affleck as Batman. I just thought the movie was just terrible. Yeah. But
I left. I couldn't stay. I just hated it.
I mean.
I rarely leave a movie, probably about six times in my
life. It was
bad. I've only left one movie.
But Zack Snyder, you know, and I like Zack Snyder visually, but he doesn't get it. He really doesn't. And that's why Justice League, as bad as it was, they really tried to lighten it up because people are sick of heroes with angst, and Superman doesn't need that. But anyhow.
Well, okay, go ahead.
This is from 1978, Superman the Movie Guide.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And two of my most prized possessions.
It's like pornography for you.
This Jeez. Is a program from the movie Ralph and I went to
Ooh.
In 1978. I still have it. Dedication to Jeffrey Unsworth, the cinematographer who died before the film came out. And actually, all it is the cast and everyone who worked on the production. No pictures or anything. But I also got that night a little Superman button from 1978 that I have. So for me... And I don't know if this is number one or number two in 78, but this was top box office for several weeks. So people flocked to this movie. I saw this movie about 80 times in the movie theater in 1978. So I love this movie. I love Christopher Reeves.
I really have a hard time believing that I didn't see it. I can't imagine why I didn't see it, but I just have no memory of seeing it.
It was one of the biggest movies in 78.
I just don't think I saw enough movies in 1978. I think that was the problem.
And the performances, all the big name cast, the way they like the phone booth, all the tributes to the Superman legend. I'm here to fight for truth, justice, and American way. He might look like a mild mannered reporter. And on the train, the little girl who saw Clark running was Kirk Allen and Noel Neal from the original
Lane,
Superman
right.
serial.
Yeah,
and that's Lois Lane.
Yeah, well, she was from the TV show and the original.
Well, there's a scene they cut where she says, "Lois Lane, you're such a good reporter."
Well, the expanded movie is actually pretty good. It's like 3 hours long.
Oh, of Superman, this one?
Yeah, it's actually pretty good. But but this movie, I'm just telling you, without this movie, Batman with Michael Keaton and Jack Nicholson would not have happened. A lot of this Marvel stuff wouldn't have happened because it was the first time a comic book was taken seriously and done with a lot of talented people, a lot of top-notch actors. It wasn't the TV show. So none of that would have happened without this movie. And if you listen to a lot of directors, not the younger generation, they all talk about this movie as the one that you look at when you want to do a superhero movie, right? Even Bryan Singer practically remade it. Now he did a horrible job and that movie was terrible, but he appreciated the Donner version of it and his vision for a superhero movie. That's what I loved about it, because for me, everyone, you know, my father used to call them funny books, you know, oh, you're reading your funny books again. No one took it seriously. And then a movie like that comes out, a real movie that does big box office and takes itself seriously. There was humor in it, but it took itself seriously. And then for me, Christopher Reeve, the best thing was after he spins the world around, and which was stupid. I'm not going to pretend like it wasn't stupid. It was stupid. But
I have a question about that.
Standing there, and she gets out of the car, and he just saved her life. And the first thing he says, and the way he says it, he chokes a little bit. He goes, "Hi." He goes, "Just hi."
Yeah.
And that to me was like, "Oh my god!"
And her death scene before that.
It was
pretty
awful.
Brutal, right?
Yeah,
she gets buried under there. That was a pretty brutal scene.
And
she's in that white
all dirty
pantsuit she's wearing. It's all filthy and dirty. And now that ending was supposed to be in part two or something. That whole spinning the world around.
That's right.
which That's time right. was for part yeah. two, but given what they, we haven't even really talked about Gene Hackman and what he brought to the table. And
well, one know, thing about the spinning the world around, now that he could do that, why didn't he keep going back and save his father?
Well, that's well. Did he spin the world? He spun the world backwards. It didn't stop any of the destruction, other than
well, that's the thing. Also, too, you think right. he went back? He had it back far enough to save Lois Lane, but why didn't he go back far enough to stop the missile?
It's see, you can't do that.
John, let me say this: we can question that, but I'll tell you what: in Man of Steel, he broke a guy's neck. That Superman would never do.
Wow. Okay. Oh. Nerd alert.
Is this your niece?
No. This is.
Does she want to talk about Superman?
Permission to be. Claudia, come here. 1 second.
I want to know what she thinks of Superman.
No, she didn't see it. Claudia.
Oh, did. Claudia did. Hi, Claudia.
My granddaughter, Claudia.
Hi, Claudia.
How are you?
Hey,
Claudia.
Hey. Claudia, did you see Superman?
You're 8 years old. Was this the first time you saw Superman?
Actually, no. I've actually seen it before, but I think this one was really good.
Claudia, I like
it. You didn't want to watch it too, didn't you? You were like, you
want. At first, I didn't want to watch it.
Why, too boring? It's going to be boring and long and slow.
I thought it would be boring and long, but really, good.
What was your favorite part, Claudia?
My favorite part was when he spun the whole world around
and saved her.
Yeah.
Like nobody can ever do that, and I'm wondering how he could breathe up there because no oxygen.
No, he doesn't breathe.
He doesn't need oxygen.
Yeah, I know. It's hard to believe. It's hard to get your.
That's good. I'm glad you liked it. That's great. Yeah.
And did you like? Was it romantic with the girl and the boy?
Gross. That's gross.
You didn't like that.
Yeah.
Huh?
Did you like it when he saved her from falling from the helicopter?
No, I thought that was awesome.
Yo, you like
awesome.
That?
Yeah. I mean, the most comedy in the thing was when he's catching all those criminals, and the crowbar bounces off his head,
yeah, and saving the cat.
The cat and the
guy saved the cat.
The cat burglar. He interrupts in the middle.
Yeah.
Oh wait. Oh, wait. That was really also funny when the mom spanked the girl.
Yeah. I told you never to lie to me. I can't believe you caught that. That's pretty good.
Yeah.
I caught that. It was like.
Very good. Yeah, when she went in the house, she was yelling at her.
Like,
terrible mother.
No, who was going to believe that somebody's flying in a tree?
Exactly.
I mean, come on.
That man swooped down.
The mother should watch the news.
Maybe.
That's right.
Maybe.
Oh, so, that's good.
Good. Good job, Claudia.
Good
Any
job, part, Claudia.
Do you have anything else to say?
So, Claudia, yippee-ki-yay or yippee-ki-nay?
Yippee-ki-yay means you liked it. Yippee-ki-yay. Yippee-ki-nay means you didn't like it.
I liked it.
So say yippee-ki-yay.
Oh, just give us a thumbs up. That's all. All right. Thank you,
She
Claudia.
Won't even say our brand name. Come on. That's all right.
Can you
That's
say right. yippee-ki-yay for us?
No.
There's two other people I don't know. There's two
That's
other.
Great.
Well, they're brothers. Look at them. Do they look alike?
Wait, really?
Yeah. Which one's older? Is this one older? Or is
oh, please. I got all the white hair. You're going to ask her who's older. You see my Superman costume?
Oh, yeah.
Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
Wait, I think I know. I think I know.
Okay.
So I think since, like, when you get older, you always get shorter. So I think it might be...
Him or him? Him?
Yeah.
He's correct. She said Ralph.
Ah! Thank you, Claudia.
And wiser, Claudia. I'm older and smarter.
Could be.
Yeah, so
not
that's
really. Not really, but.
How about
so
that?
Any final words?
Agrees with us. I love it.
Yeah.
If Superman doesn't have a, if Superman has a five star at the, doesn't have a five star at the bottom with the stars, I think it should have a five star.
It should have a five star review.
At least a five.
Yeah. I agree.
That's definitely a yippee-ki-yay.
The sequels, not so much.
No, the sequel, no, Superman 2 is great.
I like Superman 2.
Well, we'll watch Superman 2, okay?
Yeah.
Well, not tonight, but sometime soon. So say goodbye.
Bye, Claudia.
Bye, Claudia.
She's been wanting to get on YouTube, and guess what?
Guess what? She's
on.
Good news is...
She is on.
Tell everybody. Tell all your friends.
He doesn't like listening to his podcast.
Subscribe.
What are you going to do? It's okay.
But I do like watching YouTube.
Good. So,
good.
Well, you can see yourself now. Okay. Bye. Peace out.
So that scene,
I got a pizza.
That scene with the cat burglar.
Yeah.
When he goes by the guy at the desk.
Yeah.
That guy was upside down, bolted to that desk.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
That guy was upside down.
The making of this is fantastic.
Yeah.
Like, you know when he kicked the football?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was a cannon right below his foot. But when the movie, they go from him kicking it and they cut directly to the train.
Mm-hmm.
So when I first saw that, I like, the football's going to hit the train. That's what I thought the joke was. And then all of a sudden you see him running next to the car.
Yeah, the running looked a little funky, but who cares?
Well, but
because they would not be able to – they didn't have the special effects capability.
They had to do it practice.
Add that football.
No,
he almost got killed. A stuntman saved his life. He just missed that train.
Really?
Yeah.
But he jumped in front of a real train?
He was on a harness that – he was it was like a puppet almost thing. So he wasn't touching the ground.
These people are crazy. Oh,
by the way, that kid, Jeff East, who plays Clark Kent, they made him up to look like Christopher Reeve.
His voice was Christopher Reeve.
Well, unbeknownst to him.
Oh, really?
They didn't know they were going to dub his voice. So him and Connor didn't talk for a long time.
Well, who could he care? He's in the movie.
Because they didn't tell him.
Oh.
So he's emoting all this stuff, you know, thinking he's going to – because, first of all, he had to go through makeup to make him look like Christopher Reeve that he hated.
Yeah.
So he did it, but then when he sees the film and he realizes it wasn't his voice, he didn't know that.
Did he do anything else after this?
Yeah. He did after Porky's and all those movies. He did a movie like that.
He was in Porky's?
No. It was Up the Creek. I think it was called Up the Creek.
We may have to do. Up the Creek.
Up the Creek.
He was played the bad guy in it.
Oh, we gotta
Porky's.
We should do Porky's. That's a classic.
Listen, that'll
be great for
one of the funniest movies I've ever seen with Lassie.
Porky's?
That scene with Lassie.
I've never seen Porky's.
Oh my God, the funniest scene.
I have it on one of my laser.
Every
discs
time I see it, I want to bust the gut.
Really?
I'll tell you what. That's a film I went to see. A friend of mine got us tickets to the premiere. And we went to, you know, the local premiere in Baltimore, the movie Porky's. He brought his girlfriend. I brought my girlfriend.
Oh,
our girlfriends were so appalled.
Of course. That's made us leave.
So, the following night, there was another premiere of it. He had tickets for that. We went. You know.
Remember Pee-wee? Oh, wait. We're getting off.
Yeah. Stop. All right. Real quick.
Save it for the movie.
Gene Hackman was fantastic.
Yeah.
As he always is.
He wouldn't do the bald cap. Right. Refused to do bald. And, of course, anyone who knows the comic knows Lex Luthor was bald till the end.
He did it.
He didn't want to shave his mustache. So Richard Donner had put a fake mustache on. Said, if I shave mine, will you shave yours? Gene Hackman said yes. Gene Hackman shaves his. Richard Donner goes like this, pulls it off.
That's nice.
He had the mustache for some movies, and he just didn't want to shave it. But he was good because as funny as he was, he kills people in that movie.
Oh, what he does that line he says with do you take pleasure in almost – I forget what – Superman asked him.
Do you take pleasure in, like, thinking about killing millions of people?
Right.
By causing the death of millions of people.
he's bad. And then Larry Hagman's in there.
Yep.
And that's a small role because that was after Dallas.
Well, right. It was supposed to be a week. He was there like 6 weeks.
With that whole
and Cliff Clavin's in it. John Ratzenberger.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Ratzenberger's in the missile. He's a missile tech.
Function negative, sir.
So, yeah, I mean, it's
it was
my
a great
favorite line. By the way, here's my favorite line in the whole movie. When Lois asks him, what's your name? Do you have a first name? You mean like Ralph or something?
Hey. What do you mean, like Ralph?
Yeah, like Ralph. Like
Ralph Superman.
How big are you? Excuse me? I mean...
That's what I mean. That scene
all
plays
your bodily
very
functions.
And she says, "Do you like pink?" Oh, I like pink. Yeah. Come on.
He didn't say it like that.
He said, "I like pink."
What color is my underwear? Oh, I kind of have trouble seeing through lead. Then she walks away.
That was a big mistake.
Pink.
You shouldn't be revealing your weaknesses.
Well, here's the thing. Okay, so we see the entire conversation that he has with Lois, right, in that scene.
Right.
The entire conversation, but when they read the newspaper, he starts throwing out all this stuff that never got said and extrapolates it out to the point where he comes up with kryptonite based on the article. That I thought was kind of stupid.
And what book? He went to a National Geographic magazine.
National Geographic.
Yeah.
And the kryptonite was in Addis Ababa. What are they wearing? It looks like a burnous.
Yeah. I mean, one
question about Sorry, go on. I forgot I had a point I was going to make.
Even rewatching this movie, and I've seen it so many times. And don't get me wrong. Like, I love the Marvel movies. I love The Dark Knight. I like the original, the Batman with Michael Keaton. It's just that this was done. I don't want to sound stupid, but it looked like the people who made this had a lot of joy in making this.
Yeah.
It was a fun movie. Everything I've read about it was really difficult to make.
Yeah, the producers were killing Donner.
Yeah, they were. Yeah. And that's why he ultimately, got fired from the second film, even though most of it was done.
And I think the crew knew that, and the crew knew he was protecting them from all that crap he was dealing with.
That's right.
Obviously you can see that they put a lot of effort and love into this film.
Love for the character.
Yeah.
And that's something that in these movies that we see today, I don't see a lot of that.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean they're not good movies, because Ralph knows I love all those movies. But there's something about this movie. Again, I say without this movie, those others wouldn't be made. No one would take it seriously.
I've never had the reaction. When I heard this guy's, when I watched this YouTube thing, and he did not mention this movie at all, I got upset. And I don't, I'm not like John. I'm not completely immersed in this stuff. And I was upset, and I felt like this thing needs to be talked about because, A, we need some entertainment that's just fun, which, it's hard to find right now.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
And to not mention this film as one of the best comic book movies ever made seems like a crime. Actually seems like a crime, and the guy should be called out for it. And he knows way more about film than I do, this guy, so I couldn't even compete on that level. But it offended me a little bit, and it made me want to watch it again, and I'm glad I did because it was a blast.
And again, don't diminish, and I'm not saying you're doing that, but Christopher Reeve's performance in this shouldn't be diminished.
I'm not.
He was so good in this movie.
I 100% agree.
Both roles. Again, if you don't buy into this, tights. Like today, they won't wear tights in the movies. It's all got to be leather and armor and stuff. Mm. You can't get away with that today because of that, because people are going to laugh. And he pulls it off, and he looks. I mean, it looked like he walked off the page, to be honest.
Well, like you said, if it didn't work, none of these other movies would have happened, number one. Two, they all use him as the guy. He's the guy. And frankly, like you said, Bryan Singer basically hired someone who looked like a younger Chris.
Right.
And that's sort of the unofficial sequel to this film, that Superman Returns movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
And which, look, again...
Don't also think about all these superhero movies and the music. I want to know, can you hum any music from these current movies?
Wonder Woman's pretty cool.
Okay,
fair enough. I like that one.
But this one, this is iconic.
Oh, my God.
Everybody plays it. I mean,
the hair stands on my arm when I hear that.
He said, Richard Donner said when he first heard the theme, and it went, bum, ba-da, ba-da-da-da. He said it said to him, Superman. That's what he heard when he heard that bar of music. And he was like, this is, and this is the guy who just did Star Wars.
And then, boom, when he does that, come on.
And how about those credits? Those were the longest credits I ever saw.
Some might argue a little too long.
Well,
they go on forever.
I don't dispute that, but I read something where they spent more on the credits than most movies' budgets at the time.
Well, that effect that they did, that sweeping thing was whatever. A, it's been copied over and over, and B, you'd never seen that.
No.
And that's what I mean. We sat
and now we could do it for like nothing,
Of course. But we sat in that movie theater. I remember sitting there like those credits go on for what, 10 minutes, something like that. They go on for a long time.
With that Superman logo just bursting on the screen.
And I can't explain that the rousing crowd that was there that night.
And it was critics.
Yeah.
And they were like little kids.
That's what I mean. It's hard to put yourself back in that thing, and it was just fantastic.
Well, like young people would complain about the effects, but I still say some of the effects, some of the process shots didn't look so good, but there were times where he's on a fishing pole and he's literally being launched into the air. It's like that stuff looked fantastic.
Yeah. Well, like you were saying, the stuff they were doing where they're hanging people upside down so it looks like he's flying by them, and even the walk that the cat burglar does where
he
suction cup ends up on his foot. And one of my favorite scenes is when Superman lets that guy fall and he flies up behind
him. Going down?
And going down. And the guy's flashlight's dangling below him. And you actually see all that. That's all practically happening.
Or the boat. He brings the boat outside the police
station. Yeah.
So, anyway, look at a bunch of
And, of course, the police are like, okay.
A big blue bird in bright red boots.
Yeah. Now, could we have a pimp in a movie now? Could we have that guy in the yellow suit, the pimp? Could he happen in a movie now?
No. but at the time, everyone...
1978, yeah.
Hilarious.
Yeah. And that comes right after the phone booth where he runs by the phone booth.
It made a joke of the costume. Yeah. That was funny.
That was fantastic. Anything else anybody wants to add before we give our review, which I don't think is...
You know what? For those out there who haven't seen this movie or haven't seen it in a long time, and you want a little less cynicism, you want some light at the end of the tunnel, it's a great movie for that. I love the fact that it's not cynical. It's not grounded in reality like everything is today. It's a comic book movie done seriously. And at the end of it, you know, I had the same reaction I had when I've seen it all these other times. The helicopter scene, I get goosebumps watching it.
Yeah.
When that music's just pounding. It's a great insane movie to watch, and I'm so glad. I was so shocked when you picked this because I'm like,
oh, I was upset. I was upset, and
as well
I don't get like I don't care about guys with their opinion on YouTube because we all have. That's what's the whole reason we're doing
we're
this
guys
podcast
with opinions on YouTube.
Well, the whole reason we started this podcast,
but nobody
is
watches
of,
us, Seth. Right. So it's cool.
Our love of 70s.
I don't know. 1,100 people watched the taking of Pelham 1-2-3 on YouTube.
1,100.
Yeah.
All right, I gotta figure this one out.
No, someone else must have been linking to it.
Maybe.
Because it was 10 times to set number two.
Hey,
you know what? I don't know if we have, and we shouldn't be talking this inside baseball stuff, but do we have any idea of our analytics on the actual podcast? Because I still view us as a podcast.
Oh, I've only checked out analytics on the YouTube. I haven't checked out.
Yeah, the only way I can check is SoundCloud. You can see the views on SoundCloud.
But, you know, I don't get it from SoundCloud. I get it from iTunes.
All you do is sign up for SoundCloud and punch in our thing and you can have it.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is I don't view it from SoundCloud.
I don't either. I only use SoundCloud to send it to everything else.
Okay, yeah.
Wow, this really is inside baseball. Yeah. Okay, we're going to lose the two people.
I'll edit this out. Don't worry about it.
I got a question.
But I do want to say one
Everybody,
thing.
Freeze for a second.
My final thoughts of this is, some of the stuff doesn't hold up, some of the special effects, but the overall joyfulness and, you know, lack of cynicism and the playfulness and the performances certainly compensate for any failures.
Yeah, I agree.
That you would see. And it is good to see people doing practical effects rather than CGI,
is why I love the Batman, the Christopher Nolan stuff.
Yeah.
His stuff is all practical. That's what I love about his stuff. Where the Marvel stuff is like watching a cartoon now.
Yeah, that's what I was going to mention. What I was going to say is, you know, I have trouble looking back on old films and stepping out of 2020 or whatever. This one, I don't have to do that. I know when it was made. That's fine. I know the effects aren't up to what they are now. That's fine because the movie holds up without all that stuff.
Right.
In spite of that, I should say. And the fact is, you have and frankly, with what went on with Christopher Reeve later in his life,
right?
You kind of look at this with more reverence than you might if he were still alive, honestly.
Yeah.
So I mean, that makes it pretty powerful, and that's why I was really frustrated by what the guy, you know, not mentioning this at all was just. And on top of that, all that destruction that goes on in Superman, Man of Steel, drove me insane.
Right.
I just couldn't. I don't care about the breaking of the neck. They made a choice.
First of all, it's completely counter to Superman.
Okay, I get all that, but just from a movie enjoyment point of view, it's just too much. And this didn't have
everybody.
This had stakes. Lois Lane died in this movie. Obviously, he spun the world around and brought her back.
But other people died in this movie.
Right.
There was death in this movie.
Yeah. Well, and Lex was going to kill what's her name's mother,
Miss Tessmacher.
And what town in New Jersey was she? I forget.
Hackensack.
Hackensack.
I know exactly where it's going. Hackensack, New Jersey.
I love that she kisses him right before she takes a kryptonite off. Valerie,
why did you kiss me? I didn't think you'd let me later. Jeez. By the way, you know when they were showing the map of Lex Luthor's places and they had Otisburg?
Yeah.
Notice it was the Tessmacher Mountains? Yep.
She was cute. Yeah,
great, great choice. I love this movie. Now, let me make a suggestion about the next movie. We are the three amigos, and we show up every week. So I think we should take a look at our lists that we each gave and pick a movie from that list that we should do.
Find one that we each, if it coexists on our list?
Yeah.
All right.
Sean, I think you should pick it because I think I picked the last one. Ralph picked one. I think you should pick it from that list. What do you think?
Well, let me take a look and make sure I got all the lists too.
Well, you know, I definitely
you only need
the
two here. You only need our lists. We're the only ones here.
Yeah, we're the only ones here this week.
Right. I know. But, I know. Everybody, I don't know what's going on with the crew. I mean, Hassan, I think.
Whatever.
I think,
you know what? I enjoy this. This is nice. I like this. This is nice. I like.
No, I like this just as nice,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
But I like the other people's points.
So do I. They bring a different perspective.
But I think Al might be off. I think Al is done.
That's post-podcast. We'll talk about that. Right. No one cares.
All right. I think I'm cutting this
wait,
out.
Everybody freeze for a second. Okay. Reviews.
Sean? Why do we just?
So I'm gonna make an edit there.
Oh, okay.
Oh, let's freeze again, and then we'll do it.
I should put on my Superman costume.
One, two, three.
Yippee-Ki-Yay.
Okay, Sean, what's your rating?
This is definitely Yippee-Ki-Yay. I was incredibly happy to see this film again, and to watch it and enjoy it.
Good, John.
Yippee-Ki-Yay.
I say Yippee-Ki-Yay too. Yeah. With no explanation, just
unanimous.
I loved it. I felt I needed to vindicate this film. It doesn't need any vindication from me, that's for sure. But man, was
a little
it
lightness
fun to watch.
In a dark time is not.
Yeah, we needed this one. Yep. We needed this one.
I have to say, Ralph, I wasn't sure who picked this film. I thought it might have been John, and I was wondering whether you were going to get in this. I can't look back from 2020 on this one.
No, this one. No problem at all. And I'm in love. Lois Lane. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Margot Kidder playing
Lois
Lane.
She went nuts, huh? She went
nuts. Yeah. I mean, you know, everybody does when they get older. What are you going to do?
No, I mean, she was sick. She was,
I know.
I really liked it. And not so much this time, but I'm thinking, well, you know, it kind of works. Is that like little poem soliloquy she has? While
the playing? Song? Yeah. Where she sings,
isn't
yeah.
A
she
song?
Kinda, that was, a song. Was that early rap? Maybe she was rapping a little
bit. I was wondering if it was early
rap. She was supposed to sing it, and it just didn't work, so they did the poem instead.
It is a cheesy thing to drop in the middle of this, but
I will tell
what?
You this. If they kept it out and just did the flying stuff, it would have worked beautifully. I don't think they needed that. I didn't like that, but that scene is beautiful.
Didn't that it's become a hit scene. On the radio? That
yeah, it did.
A hit.
It did.
That poem.
No, it's a song. You can read my mind.
Did they actually sing it in the?
Oh yeah, they sing it. Yeah. Not her.
No, I understand.
I can't remember who.
Marnie Nixon probably. She's a sing for.
Oh, she does. That's right. She does everything.
I also didn't realize that she was flying a lot, and that scene goes on a long time. She did a lot of that flying
too.
Well,
if you read the making of it, that her and him were left up there for long periods of time in these harnesses, and she hated it, and she couldn't understand how. He could get up there and not complain about it at all.
Yeah. Oof.
It must have been awful because the rigs were pretty rough.
Well, they have their fun in number two. So
yeah. And then she got booted out of number three.
That's too bad.
Yeah.
Too bad.
But great choice, Ralph.
Right.
I really
all right. Well, yeah. So, Sean, pick one out of our group. Mash them together. Pick one that we all picked.
Okay. Sound good?
And then if anybody else joins us, then we can let them pick a movie too.
Maybe somebody watching wants to join us.
Well, again, subscribe or like
subscribe,
or whatever you're going to do, ding the bell.
Leave a comment if you want to get on board. We'd love to have you.
Somebody did recommend that Russian war film.
Yeah. You know, now, Al said, I read about that film. I had heard about that film before. So
what? Not Battleship Potemkin.
No. A new one. A kid who finds a gun, and I don't know what happens, but it's supposed to be pretty wild.
A partisan during the Second World War, Russian partisan.
Yeah.
Well, that sounds light.
Well, the trailer was very dark. It had no dialogue in it. It was.
Oh, you should see our Martyrs. Look up Martyrs, John. Martyrs? One of our Martyrs podcasts we did. You want something that isn't light? That was brutal.
Well, I
but
think
good. Good. Well done, film.
We should do Porky's and get Wojo on it next week.
Yeah,
that would be nice.
No, I can tell you one film I would like to do, and I got somebody who would defend it with me. Was Phantasm.
With the ball?
Jeez. With Angus, what's his name? The
Phantasm character. With the floating ball.
Yeah,
with the ball
with the spikes.
Now, that's Al's jive. He might actually come back to do that one.
Well, when I mentioned it to him personally off, you know, after a thing, he goes, not the first one, the second one.
Oh, really?
But to me, the first one's the interesting one.
I haven't seen that movie in, I don't know how long.
I saw it at a drive-in.
I think I've seen it once. I wouldn't mind seeing that again.
I won't go into it here, but it's interesting in that it doesn't really make any sense at all. But I think
like Hudsucker Proxy.
I think we should go out with a little John Williams music.
Oh, nice.
30 seconds worth.
That was awesome.
All right, guys.
Thanks for picking that.
All right. We'll see you next week.
See you next week, whatever. Guys.
Sean, let us know, okay?
Okay.
Take care of that cough, Sean, all right?
Okay. Bye.